Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's CLC lecture, Pathways Towards Resilient Metropolitan Jakarta. My name is Xingyi, and I will be your MC today. The CLC lecture series is organized by the Center for Livable Cities as part of our mission to distill, create, and share knowledge on livable and sustainable cities. Today, we are delighted to have invited Mr. Oswar, Muadzin, Mungkasa, Deputy Governor for Spatial Planning and Environment for the Jakarta Capital City Government. He will be sharing on how the city has transformed over the years and their efforts in strengthening the city's resilience against urban challenges and natural disasters. The format for today's lecture will start with a presentation by Pak Oswar, followed by a moderated discussion and a question and answer session with the audience. This will be moderated by Dr. Johannes Widodo, Associate Professor from School of Design and Environment, NUS. Kindly hold all your questions till the Q&A session. Thank you. With this, let us start the session by inviting Pak Oswar on stage. Pak Oswar, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for CLC to invite me to come to this really fantastic event, because I thought it was only 20 people. And then now I realize that it is more than 100, so make me nervous. Okay, as you know, my name is Oswar Mungkasa, and I'm the Deputy Governor of Jakarta. Deputy Governor is like a Vice Governor, and then in Jakarta we have 4 Deputy Governor, and then 1 real Vice Governor. So there are one real Vice Governor and 4 look like Vice Governor. Do I look like Vice Governor? Okay, so today I'm going to talk about the title is Pathways Toward Resilient Metropolitan Jakarta. And then, this is not Jakarta. I mean, this is the best part of Jakarta, and this is the other part of Jakarta. So, as you know, that the metropolitan always having two sides, a best one and then the worst one. This is my outline: the issue of Jakarta, the grand design, collaborative approach, pillars of Jakarta City Resilience Strategy, Metropolitan Challenge, and then Metropolitan Resilient Strategy. Here. There are many issues of Jakarta. I can talk about the issues of Jakarta maybe in 2 days, 48 hours. But I try to choose some issues that giving us problem in Jakarta. The first one is water and wastewater. In Jakarta, the problem is that we don't have enough water. The water that we got water from outside Jakarta. So 95% of the water, our water, is coming from our neighbor. So can you imagine if the neighbor stop giving us water, and then maybe we need to move to Singapore. Yeah, Pakko, yeah. And then, at the same time, we don't have enough water, but at the same time, we don't care about our water. So in Jakarta, you can find our river is highly polluted. 81% of our river is highly polluted, really, really polluted. Sometimes the color is black. And then the waste. In Jakarta, every day we produced 7,500 tons waste. Not too much. It is like around 300 elephants. You can put it elephants around, and this is like 4,500 tons waste every day, And then 10% of the waste, it is not, what do you call it? Untreated. 10% is untreated. So 700 ton waste in Jakarta untreated every day. You can calculate it and you can find a number, a big number for 1 year. The third is, when we're talking about transportation in Jakarta, let's say from my house, it is only 15 kilometers from my house to my office. And then it would take 2 hours from my house to my office, only 15 kilometers. So the problem in Jakarta regarding the transportation, public transportation, is really, really bad. The other thing is that inequality in Jakarta, maybe around 20% of the people is consider they are poor, like me maybe. And then that's the urban issues. But actually, there are two issues that really, really giving us problem. The one that we call it fragmented governance. Why? Because Jakarta is metropolitan. We cannot, treat Jakarta only as a city of Jakarta, but as a metropolitan. So in Jakarta, let me see if we have the map. Here. In Jakarta metropolitan, there are 3 governors. And around 8 mayors. And Jakarta led by governor, not by mayor. So can you imagine? If we need water, we need to talk with Tangerang, with the mayor of Tangerang. And then when we talk about solid waste, our final disposal area is in Bekasi. So every year, we provide funding to Bekasi around 29 million US dollar to make sure that we can put our garbage in Bekasi. So this is one of our big problem, fragmented governance. It is not easy to solve our problem in Jakarta when we're talking about water. When we're talking about a polluted river, it is also talking about the solid waste coming from our neighbor. So the people outside Jakarta, they dump their waste into the river. Sometimes you can find bed. I believe there's sometimes a freezer, or I don't know, a TV or everything. And then this all goes to Jakarta, and then we are the victim. So fragmented governance. That's one of our big problem when we're talking about how to solve Jakarta, or we're talking about Jakarta. And then the other thing, the second really, really big problem when you're talking about governance issues in Jakarta is that what we call it working in silos. In Jakarta, when we're talking about, like, let's say, river, we are talking about the central government, we are talking about the water sources agency, we are talking about a public work agency, and then sometimes they don't talk each other. They go to the coffee shop, they go to the bar, but they never talk about the job. They talk about other things. So we are talking about working in silos. That's why if you go to Jakarta, you can see there are many development there, but you can see sometimes the problem is uncoordinated, or because we don't never talk each other. But sometimes we don't talk each other. So there are 2 things that really hinder us to solve our urban issues. So for me, the governance issues is much more important than the urban issues. When we're talking about urban issue, I think every single city in the world, they know how to solve the problem. But when we're talking about fragmented governance and working in silos, I think not many metropolitan or city in the world know how to deal with these problems. So this is working in silo. No coordination, they work separately and in comprehensive solution. If I have 30, not 30 minutes, but 30 hours, I can talk about this. But since I only have 30 minutes, I can just skip it. And then, how to deal with working in silos? We introduce what we call it a grand design. What is a grand design? Grand design is like, this is not a technical guidance, this is not a master plan. This is something that, this is like, there are two words very important when talking about grand design. Commitment and consensus. Because we are working in silos, we need the commitment from every single agency that we have one problem, that we have two problems, or we need to commit to solve our problems. That's what we call it commitment. And then the second is how to solve the problem. This is what we call it consensus. So every single agency need to do what, when, where, and etc. So commitment and consensus, we put it in a document that we call grand design. So when we talking about grand design, we're talking about the issue. What is the issue? And then we started from the issue. What would be the causes of the issue? And then what would be the solution? And then who is going to do the solution? That's the idea of a grand design. So this is like implementing of the collaborative approach, a common understanding, commitment, consensus, and the grand design. So now in Jakarta, we already launched a grand design of a green building, child-friendly city, water and domestic wastewater, urban farming, waste management. If you see the grand design, it just look, it seems like, what do you call it? We have a problem with slum, but there's no grand design of slum here. Why? Because when we're talking about grand design, the problem of the grand design, when we try to to develop the grand design, I need to find a partner from outside the government, not from inside government. So that's why sometimes I'm waiting for someone from outside government to help me on this issue. So later on, I found someone one or two organizations that can help us regarding slums. That's why I just started to develop a grand design just some times ago, because I need someone to help me. Because I need someone to understand, some organization that understand and having experience on how to deal with all these issues. So now we develop a community-based disaster risk reduction, slums, groundwater, and air pollution. And this is some of our organization that helping us on this grand design. This is one of the example of the grand design. This is a water and domestic wastewater provision. So as I mentioned before, that we started with the issues. This is very important. Why? Because in Jakarta, when every year we try to develop our yearly budget, but we are always starting with our role, not the issue. So that's why when we're talking about starting with the role, and then the problem is this is like a puzzle. One spot, nobody care about the spot. But in some case, one spot is too many agencies care about this spot. So if we started with the issues, and then we never, when we start the developing the grain design and started with the issue, we don't talk about our role. We talk about issues first. What would be the issues? What the causes? What would be the solution? And then later on, after we find, if we agree, we agree on the solution, and then we come. We are going to talk about who is going to do, and then regarding our role. So the role is later on. We started with issues first, like when we're talking about water and domestic wastewater provision. We're talking about the water resources availability. In Jakarta, we don't have enough water. So we try to find how to deal with this problem. And then the access to drinking water is also shortage, and then et cetera, et cetera. So we come up with these five strategic issues. And then this is what we call it commitment and consensus. So when we talk, when we develop the grain design, we invite all the stakeholders, not only the government, the NGO, the university, and et cetera, et cetera. And then what would be the function of the grain design? One is, of course, direction for collaboration. Because as I mentioned before, that when we try to solve the problem, we all involved on this solution. So this is like a direction for collaboration, the reference for stakeholders, who is doing what, and then this is a reference for sectoral midterm planning. So after we develop the grain design, we try to internalize this into our medium-term planning in our government document. And of course, by having this grain design, we believe that we can accelerate the implementation, because we can make our activities more efficient and effective. So this is the step, the phase of the grain design, overview the issue, objective and milestone. So this is like our commitment, and then the strategy of innovation is like our consensus from here to here. In Jakarta, there are two important steps. The first step is what we call it paradigm shift and raising awareness. Why? Because here, from our experience, we found out that why we are working in silos, because actually many of us don't understand the problem, don't understand and don't care about the problem. They just care about how to fulfill their key performance indicator. They don't talk about the issues. They talk about how to, at the end of the year, they can use all the money, and then they can fulfill their key performance indicator. Sometimes it is nothing to do with the issues. So the first step that we try to do is try to shift the paradigm, and then raising the awareness that this issue is important. That's the water is problem in Jakarta. Wastewater is problem in Jakarta, and then because of we don't have enough water, and then our people getting water from the deep well. And then what's happening in Jakarta? Jakarta sinking every year around, on average, 8 centimeters a year. So in 10 years, like this. So in some places in Jakarta, in 15 years, they need to build a new house. Yeah, because it's already sinking like this this high. So we need to raising awareness from the decision maker. And then if we manage to have the grain design, and then we need to internalize into the city resilience concept or into the government document. to make sure that we can implement this idea in a government policy. And then, of course, we try to conduct it in with a collaborative approach. As I mentioned before, we involve the government, private sector, academicians, civil society, etc., etc. And then, here, before we're talking about green design, and then we find out that if we only stop in the grand design, and we can have many green sign in Jakarta. And then we have another problem. Why? Because of too many grand design, and then another problem is too many grand design. So this why we need to have a, like one umbrella to make sure that all of the grand design is working in the same direction, working in the in under one umbrella. So since 2016, since 2016 we joined 100 RC, 100 resilient cities facilitated by the Rockefeller Foundation. Here, Sam is the boss. And then through the resilient city strategy, we come up with the, there are three important issues that we need to make sure that we need to focusing when we're talking about resilience in Jakarta. One is the readiness of the people, the government, and the system in Jakarta. The second is healthy Jakarta. It means that we need to provide clean water, wastewater, and then of course a sustainable solid waste management. And then also, we're talking about the pillar three, talking about connected Jakarta. This is an integrated transportation system. And then, now we are happy in Jakarta because we just start to have MRT in Jakarta. So, since yesterday, it's open to public, and then everybody happy. We don't have to go to Singapore to try MRT. From the airport, I took MRT. Why? Because I tried to compare with our MRT in Jakarta. And you know what? Singapore is much better. Yeah, Pako. I like MRT in Singapore, but it seems like our MRT is as good as Singapore. Yes. Why? Why? Because we learn from Singapore, right? Yeah, Pako, yeah? Yeah. So, and then there are two pillars that really support these three pillars. This is the governance, like we mentioned before, fragmented governance. We have a problem, so one of the pillars is governance, and then social cohesion. We also try to focusing on social cohesion. Why? Because in Jakarta, we have many, many, what do you call it? Not migrant. What commuter, every day 2 million people in the morning come to Jakarta, 2 million, not too many. It's like it's like a country in the Europe, right? Yeah, Pak Sam, yeah. And then in the afternoon they go back to their place, including me. I'm from Tangerang Selatan, so every day I take a train. So I'm part of the problem, actually. That's why I really try to solve the problem because I'm part of the problem. So, and then I'm trying to, let me talk about a little bit about land subsidence in Jakarta. Actually, this is the problem is because you don't have enough water. That's why our second pillar is water. You don't have water. We got water from Tangerang, and then every year, the price of the water is getting higher. Every year, we have to deal with them every year to get water. And then, at the same time, because of there's no water, we got water, especially the people living in the northern part of Jakarta, they get water, they get water from the deep well, and then we get a land subsidence. So that's why water is very, very much important in Jakarta to make sure that we can stop the land subsidence. I can imagine we cannot stop this, and then in 30 years, what do you call it? We go down like 2 meters. It's more than my height. So this is really important. And then the second, you know what? Maybe in Singapore, I don't know if you do have a fire in Singapore, Pak. No, I think yes, but not like Jakarta. In Jakarta, every day 5 fires. In Jakarta, five incidents of fire in Jakarta every day. So this is one thing that really problem in Jakarta. That's why when we're talking about resilience in Jakarta, we're talking about the readiness of the people. The problem in Jakarta, when they got fire, they're waiting for the firefighter to come, and then they just watch watch the movie. Yeah, to see the house because they don't know how to deal with the fire. So that's why one of our pillars is to make people ready. To make people ready. That's why if you see the grand design here, one of our grand design is community-based disaster risk reduction, to make sure that the community understand how to solve the problem when they got earthquake, when they got landslide, when they have fire, et cetera, et cetera. So if we have this, we believe that we can have direction, how to make sure that they understand their role. Okay, see, I think this is really contradictory. We have a big high-rise building on the back, and then solid waste in front. So I already mentioned about the problem in Jakarta. Look, this is you see the solid waste here on the river. Actually, this is in the afternoon. In the morning, it's already clean. We clean this river sometimes 3 times a day, like take a medicine. In the morning, it's clean, and then in the afternoon, it's already full of waste. And then we ask the people, why you put waste here? In the morning, it's already clean. And then they say, like, look, if you don't put waste here, and then your staff don't do nothing. We should provide them with something to do. Because they got money from the government. So can you imagine? They dump their waste not because they try to make sure that we do our job. This I don't think you have it in Singapore. Yeah, maybe long time ago. So public transportation. This is now. In every morning, if we take a train, this is what happening. But now, since we have MRT, maybe we believe that in the near future, we can solve our problem. And then we also have a busway in Jakarta. And then now, busway, MRT, LRT, all connected in one cycle. So we believe we are much better later on. This is a virus one here. Governance. As I mentioned before, this governance is really important. Why? Because we need to collaborate. This is important. We need to collaborate. Why? Because in Jakarta, actually, the private sector, they have the funding. They have really, really big funding compared to the government. So we need to work with the private sector. We need to work with the community in the field to make sure that we can solve our problem efficiently and effectively. Integrative regarding the plan, so we have a grand design here, and then participative to make sure that our grand design, it is really include all the stakeholders, and then innovative. And then when we're talking about social cohesion, we're talking about fairness, equity, and dialogue. This is important, dialogue, because before, now we try to make Jakarta as a city 4.0. City 4.0 when the government is the collaborator and the people and the community is co-creator. So dialogue is important. Before, like 10 or 15 years ago, the government only invite the people to come to the gathering, and then just tell them, look, the government would like to do this, and then please be ready. And now this is not the case. We invite them to talk and then to discuss, and of course later on after we agree on the solution, and then the government will take action. See, this is our idea that city resilience strategy is an umbrella for all of our grand design to make sure that we can break through, solve our problem, our issue of the working in silos. And then this is our Jakarta stakeholder. There are many actually. Oh, sorry, Sam, there's no 100 RC here. Randy's fault. So social cohesion, governance, this is our strategy, and we have a grand design to make sure that our strategy can be implemented efficiently and effectively, and this is our friend. And then we have another issue now. From our experience when we're talking about City of Jakarta, not Metropolitan of Jakarta, we found out that our city resilience strategy is not complete yet. Why? We need to talk about a metropolitan, not only Jakarta as a city. So that's why now we have a new agenda, a next agenda that we need to have city resilience strategy for the metropolitan. So the name is not city now, but a metropolitan resilient strategy. Why? Because as I mentioned before, we have a problem of fragmented governance. Jakarta also have five major, but the major in Jakarta appointed by the governor. So this is like only a coordinator, but the surrounding area, we have eight major. We have a problem with the waste that we need to put in our neighbor. We have, can you imagine in Jakarta, the population only 10 million, but the bicycle, motorcycle, and the only motorcycle, 18.7 million. So I don't know, maybe we used to at the same time. I don't know why the Jakarta people really like motorcycles. And then, of course, the clean water, the river, and the land subsidence, all these problems actually only can be solved by collaborated with the neighbor. And then this is our next agenda. So, but actually now we try to solve the problem by having what we call it metropolitan coordinating body. But the problem is this body, it is like only asking Jakarta to provide funding to the neighbor. Every year, we provide funding to Bekasi up to 29 million per year for landfill management. We get we give a grant to Bogor Regency around $500,000 per year. We give to Depok City $2.7 million for the water catchment area. And then also we give to Tangerang 1.70 million for normalize the sum of the rivers. So now if we found out that it is like, what do you call it, the bendahara apa ya? I don't know in English. We are like treasurer for our neighbor. Every year we provide funding, this one. Be a good boy, because if you are a bad boy, and then we got problem. So now we try to change the way we solve the problem in Jakarta. And then that at the same time, we have the, what we call it, Authority for Metropolitan Transportation Management. This is also, we provide funding to our neighbor to make sure that their station, the bus station, is in a good condition, so the people will happy to take bus to go to Jakarta. And then we provide a low fare bus from our neighbor to Jakarta. And this is really huge money every year, because our neighbor thinking that Jakarta is rich. Do we look like a rich guy? No. So this is our problem. So now we solve problem by providing funding to our neighbor. We call it environmental services every year. So this is too much. So our idea is try to have like metropolitan resilience strategy. By having this, we believe we can have a plan to solve the problem by all of the stakeholders, including the government, and then the private sector, and then of course the community. So we now already finalize our resilient city strategy in the city of Jakarta, and then we have a confidence that we can do it in a metropolitan we can do it in a metropolitan area later on. I believe after this is terima kasih. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Palsa, for your insightful sharing on Jakarta's key challenges, the importance of tackling the governance issue first, and the collaborative approach in the form of the Metropolitan Resilience Strategy and Grand Designs to solve Jakarta's urban issues. We would like to request for Palsa to remain on stage and now invite our moderator, Dr. Widodo, on stage for the sharing session and panel discussion. Dr. Widodo will be opening up the floor for questions after the panel discussion. Please hold your questions till then. During the Q&A, please state your name and organization before asking questions or making comments. You might like to raise your hand and my colleagues will walk to you with the handheld mics. But also, Dr. Widodo, please.
Okay, thank you. Well, this is just relax, right? I think it's the time now is very, it's a sleeping time. Coffee time, actually. No, but it's thank you for the very interesting presentations, because I know you are quite resilient. I mean, yeah. You are in the previous governor, now you are still in the government.
Yeah. My friend doesn't believe that I can survive.
Okay, now you are talking about this grand design needs, right? And grand design, of course, needs long-term solutions. You cannot just have one governor halfway go to jail, or in the next government, there will be next elections every 5 years, and then we have to coordinate these three governors, other provinces also will go for elections. So the fragmentation is not just about the governance, but also about the political situations. And we know that dealing with the political situation in Jakarta is not easy. So, maybe before I open this to questions, just want to further discuss this issue about the long-term positions, because as I know, the civil service in Indonesia is not like civil service in Singapore. Here, you can build up your career for many years. You have a permanent secretary here. But in Jakarta, maybe on the echelon one, echelon two, it can remain two or three more periods for governance. But for echelon three, echelon four, echelon five, maybe only stay for 1 month, sometimes it's 1 year. And they move around the different agencies. So is this issue has been handled properly, or you know, what is the strategy actually dealing with all this stability and long-term positions?
Yeah. In the beginning, when we introduced this grand design, we never think about the changing of the staff and everything. Even I managed to to work with, I believe, five governors. Yeah, Pak Aho, Pak Jarot, Pak Sony. Four governors and two vice governor. But the process of grand design still there. Why? Finally, we found that it is really interesting that the grand design is really bonding us. Because once we finalize the grand design, it is like the idea is there, the soul is there, everything is there. It doesn't matter who reflects whom, the idea is there. So it is helping us to understand how to deal with the problem. Let me tell, the grand design, it is not official government document. I mean, official is not in our, not our system. We introduced this. But this is like, if you are like a governor candidate, you can read the grand design, and then you can get many idea from the grand design. And this is legitimate. Why? Because it's coming from all of the stakeholders. So this is interesting. So it doesn't matter who is the governor. The idea is the grand design is there.
I think this is also interesting because it's maybe a different definition, because normally in different countries, grand design is something official. Yeah. But as you say, it's something like in the subconsciousness. So maybe as Indonesians, we can easily understand what is going on. You can feel the heat. You can feel what is going on in the community. And then there's a kind of different kind of resilience. Can I say that? It's maybe like psychological or spiritual.
Yeah, this is resilience. This is like resilience of the idea. Yeah, to make sure that the idea is still there. It doesn't matter who is the governor.
So I think that is interesting. Do you think also in the nation level, for example, like we're dealing with Pancasila, dealing with all this issue, and some people actually very surprised after the fall of Suharto that Indonesia can hold together for so long. And it's not become like Yugoslavia.
Yeah.
There is some hidden hands.
Yeah.
So is it also happening in the level in Jakarta as well? Yeah. This kind of invisible glue?
Yeah, because I mean, we love Jakarta. Yeah. If you love something and then you try to make sure that Jakarta is still there, it doesn't matter how bad the situation.
So okay.
This is the idea that to make sure that Jakarta survive, we need to have a grand design. That's the idea.
All right. So I think I just want to open this to the floor, whether there is a question. So hopefully there are many questions. So I just open the first one. Yes, please, that gentleman.
Hi, my name is Sean. I'm from Zeroth Labs. Thank you for the presentation. It was very good. I do have a question about, what's your favorite example? What's the best example of a grand design? Because it's a bit hazy in my head. I like the concept, but I'm missing some of the specific details for what does an effective grand design project look like. And I'd also be curious as to, if it's very successful in the end, what was the process towards generating that? Was it very straightforward? Were there many turns? Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe we can just directly addressing.
Here, the first grand design in Jakarta is a grand design of a green building. Why? At the time when I joined Jakarta government only 3.5 years ago, I came from the central government. So for me, it is quite shocking when I joined Jakarta because it's totally different. In the central government, we're talking about a big picture. And as a level, in Jakarta, we're talking about everyday problem, everyday situation. So at the time, my colleagues come to me and then saying like, look, in Jakarta, we have 700 high-rise building. And then if we can make them a green building, we can save our environment. We already have a governor law, but it is not implemented yet. We need, why? Because it is the ownership of the regulation only in the government hand. The private sector, they don't believe it. The community, they don't buy the idea of a green building. What's a green building? So we try to find a way to make sure that the governor law could be implemented. So the first step is what we are doing is I call it stakeholder mapping. So we try to see who are the stakeholders when we're talking about green building, and then what is their capacity regarding the green building. After we finalize this mapping, and then we establish what we call it a green building form of Jakarta. So we invite all the stakeholders to come to the meeting to talk about issue of green building. Why the governor law could not be implemented. So it, you know what? It took 6 months before we come up with the
consensus
that this is important and then this is the causes and then we need to do this. 6 months. Just to make sure that we all on in the same boat. And then it takes 1 month before we agree on the roadmap. And then we go to the governor. We went to governor and then, look, Pak Gubernur, we don't have the grand design. We all agree on how to move forward. And then please launch the grand design. And then the governor asked me, this is a grand design. We need to implement it. Where? And then I told the governor, look, just name the location and then we build it. And then the governor mentioned about one place, Dan Mogot. This is where we built our big mosque there, yeah, a grand mosque there, the grand mosque of Jakarta. Istiqlal is not is a Pak Jokowi's mosque, not Jakarta mosque. So we declare that this area is a green zone. Now we develop 7 apartment for the poor there, surrounding the mosque. So now, if you ask me how to make sure that the green design is implemented, we have the pride project. It is 17 hectares. Now is in 2021 we are going to launch this area. So and then the funding coming from the private sector, contribution from the private sector, and then the government only provide some of the funding, like to train the community, etc. So this is how we try to develop a grand design and to implement it.
So I think the answer is quite interesting, is it to highlight that the consensus to build harmonious decision-making process, yeah, regardless the time that it takes,
yeah,
that is more important than the outcome itself, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah,
the consensus or musyawarah untuk mufakat,
yeah, right? Yeah. I
mean, that is the things that probably answer that questions.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, is there any other questions? The lady?
Hi, thank you for the interesting talk. Can I just ask a little bit more about your grand design on urban farming? Could you share a little bit more about the goals, actions, and plans in regards to that? Thank you.
Okay. Here, sometimes when you look at our grand design, you are not going to find any technical, what do you call it, whatsoever there, like, what would be the technique, hydroponic or no? We don't put it there. Only commitment and consensus there. Like here, in the, our grand design, we have a vision. We have a mission. Mission is like what we're gonna do in the next like 30 years, and then we have a target. It is really difficult to agree on the target, like. In our grand design, urban farming, I forget the number. I believe 30% of this our area are going to be what do you call it, covered by urban farming, including the high-rise building. So now, all of our stakeholders try to fulfill the target, but. We don't mention there about the technology, about no. This is only consensus commitment that we all agree to make Jakarta, 30% of Jakarta area is urban farming. That's the only the idea. There's no like how to do a hydroponic or aquaponic or whatever ponic that we have.
So can you just say that it is mostly like it's managing fluid and not managing solid?
Yeah.
So you manage the flow.
Yeah, you manage flow. Yeah.
As long as it's flowing, then it will eventually will yeah. reach the objectives.
And then the grand design is not like once we finalize and then that's all. No, this is a dynamic. This is like a dynamic document. We have a regular meeting. We have a monthly meeting. After 6 months, sometimes we change, we revise our grand design. It's okay because this does not belong to the government. This is belong to the stakeholders. They can change whatever they want. At least this is a consensus.
So it's more like Tai Chi.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, it's like
okay. Yeah. It flows and yeah. harmonies. And okay, another next questions. Mr. Gentleman at the middle. Yes.
Hi, my name is Reza. Thanks for the talk. So I want to mention a little bit about what you mentioned. One of the grand design is about transportation, right? I think what's interesting about Jakarta, at least for now, is how one of the transportation, which is Gojek, is really big, and how their role in the public transportation system as a whole, which is as a feeder system, right? And I think what you mentioned just now, when this is not a strict document, it's not a strict regulation, so it's more about the idea, right? And I think Gojek happened similar to that, so it's not planned to be that way, but it happens. So my question to you now is like, in the future, how do you imagine the governor or the government will work with people like Gojek, which is the private, which has a lot of resources, a lot of data about the transportation, to actually make public transportation in Jakarta better? Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Here, regarding the grand design, we haven't touched the transportation subject when we're talking about grand design. There are two reasons why. Because transportation is not under my jurisdiction. That's other deputy governors. The second, in Indonesia now, the Gojek is still controversial. even for the central government. So we don't want to touch that. Not because we don't understand or we don't realize the problem, but it seems like, we are waiting for the central government to make sure that everything is already in place. So that's why we don't have any grand design for the Gojek. Maybe I'll ask the Deputy Governor of Transportation in Jakarta to start to have a grand design of Ojek. So the name is GDO. Mm.
The Bandung mayor just forced everyone to take Gojek and fine 50,000 rupiah. You know. Yeah. There's a lot of controversy that just yesterday.
Yeah.
So I think the answer that is another strategy in the grand design implementations beside consensus and harmony that just talked just now is don't touch. So you cannot deal with that, don't touch it. And watch, right? And see, and then how we can deal with that.
The idea is that the first time when we try to develop a grand design, try to testing the water first. If it's okay, there's no apa buaya,
alligator,
crocodile. It's okay. If there's there, and then try to avoid it.
Okay. So we learned our lesson also with mobike, with bicycles, millions of bicycles. But we learned the lesson. We play with the crocodiles. But well, let's see. Because Gojek is also coming to Singapore and see how it happened. Okay. Next questions. Maybe the lady at the back.
Thank you so much for the presentation. My name is Lisa. I'm from Future Cities Laboratory. I'm currently interested on one of the factor of groundwater extraction and the water issue in Jakarta. And read in some articles that actually all the groundwater majority is taken in the industrial area within the North Jakarta area. And then my question here is that what are the current efforts to tackle those like groundwater extraction within the industrial area? Are there any incentive in taxes if they kind of like manage their own like water resources? Or what are the examples of the current effort? Thank you.
Yeah, here about the groundwater, there are many new development that the our governor tried to do when we're talking about groundwater. First, we try to provide water like here. The water company, we ask them to provide water focusing on the northern part of Jakarta. Why? Because there's no water there. In the southern part of Jakarta, the water from the sumur apa sedo
well. Deep well,
not deep well, sumur dangkal, sedo
shallow well.
They can have water from the shallow well in the southern part of Jakarta because the water there is still safe, still okay to get water from the deep well or the shallow well. But in the northern part of Jakarta, really they only get water from the deep well. So we try to focusing to provide water to the northern part of Jakarta to make sure that the industry, the people can get water. That's the first one. The second, now we try to introduce what we call it vertical drainage. Vertical drainage when we inject water directly to the land, and then we try to get to hold the water from the rainwater in some area to make sure that we can add water I'm not engineer, so it's difficult to explain. But here, instead of getting water only from the traditional sources, like from the outside the Jakarta. Now we try to inject water to the our soil, the first one, and then now we introduce to the people, to the high-rise building, to get water from the water harvesting. It is really, it is good because we in Jakarta 6 months is a rainy season, so we can get water from that. And then many other sources, like now we try to clean our river, because actually there are 13 rivers go through Jakarta, and it is all polluted. So now they try to make it clean, to make sure that we can get water from our river. It is takes time, but we try to do that. And then some area is already clean, the river, but 60% of the our river still polluted. So that's, I think there are many, but maybe I'll tell you later after this, because it's too technical. I'm not an engineer, it's difficult to explain it.
Is the water network, like the piping, is become a priority, or is it?
Yeah.
Rather than just let everyone make their own wells.
Yeah, we provide them water from the water company. Before, the water company only they don't focus in on the northern part of because it is too far, but now we try to ask them to provide water even it is too far from their sources. We push them to fight them because it is really difficult. It is a really danger for Jakarta.
Mm. Actually, some say Jakarta actually is not enough water, but sometimes Jakarta is too much water.
Too
flood
much water, yeah.
Coming from the north and the rivers. So I think the water management is one of the very interesting, and including the seawall idea. Is it still going on?
It is like it's history now.
Okay.
For the time being.
For the time being. It's like the Tai Chi, right? It's the
yeah.
Okay, any other questions? Yes, at the back.
Thank you. My name is Lim Sui King. We have just met. Just now you showed that the grand design needs some solid small project to show to the developer to carry on. I have an invention which uses the flow of the water to move the rubbish to the side of the river, which has been implemented in Singapore, most of the river. And I have tested in Bandung with the Anak Jalan using locally available material to help to clean up the rubbish and easily implemented. I wonder I can assist Jakarta in doing this as a small project for your grand design of water, so that it can be replicated over YouTube to the whole of Indonesia or developing country. I wonder who should I contact?
It's very practical questions.
Okay. Yeah, I invite you to come to Jakarta next week. Here, we have, like I mentioned before, we have like regularly meeting. We have many forum in Jakarta. We have a water forum. We have a air pollution forum, and etc. Then just let me know if you come to Jakarta, and then we can invite all the stakeholders to come to the meeting, and then you can explain your idea. I believe we can do that in some area of Jakarta.
I think the openness is also important aspect of this so-called resilience,
yeah.
Right?
When we're talking about grand design, we're talking about openness. Yeah. We're talking about egalitarian. We're talking about easy to contact, easy to talk.
Yes. Yeah. Next questions? Yes.
Hello. Yeah, I'm Harvey from the LKY Center for Innovative Cities, Singapore University of Technology and Design. Thank you for the very informative and insightful talk. My question is this: do you find it difficult to engage citizens in the urban policymaking process in general, given that you say that there's so much, so many different urban challenges? And what have been the kinds of engagement the metropolitan government has done with citizens.
Here, from my experience, every year actually we have a bottom-up planning. So starting April, we invite all the community to come to the meeting in sub, what do you call it? Kelurahan is a sub district level to come to the meeting and then to talk about their idea. The only problem, like 5 years ago, the only problem is that they come to the meeting only to hear the government telling them what to do. That's the problem. But now, we provide them enough time to express their idea, to explain their idea. Now, even open internet, if they can, they would like to access, and then they put their idea there. And then they can see where their idea now. It is already discussed when, and then what would be the result. If the government say no, and then they can get the reason why the government say no. Now it try to make sure that the idea from the community is taking care of the government. But the other problem is that not many government staff understand this idea. They still like the old-fashioned government staff that they're doing like this, this, and this. So now our challenge is to change the way our government staff doing their job, that we and the community and the people is actually, why do you call it, sitting
equal
at the
same level.
Yeah, the same level, equal. So that's one of our big challenge. Not many our government staff understand that. They still like, you know, the old fashioned. The government is having the power, asking the people to do this, then this. And then when we're talking about grand design, actually to some extent, this is like a little bit elite. Why? Because when we're talking about community participation, we're talking about representative of the community. We don't invite all the community to come, but we invite like 10 or 20 kelurahan, sub district to come to the meeting to talk about the idea, but not all the kelurahan. So the grand design that I mentioned before, it is not official process. The official process when the community come to the gathering in the sub district. But this is the grand design is talking about a big idea, not every year process.
So I guess the role of social media is very important right now, right?
Yeah,
is to talk about these big ideas. So maybe the government officers should have their own Facebook account, Twitter, WhatsApp.
But they put their picture there, not their idea.
Their picture. That's the problem, right?
Like me. You can find my picture in.
Like me too.
Yeah. So don't know me, but they don't know my idea.
Okay. So I think it's part of the engagement is the so-called the middle platform. Actually, it's getting more and more important. It's not just about big data. Yeah. But also, most importantly, is how we use this social media for medium for engagement and communication. So this big idea, grand design, has become the concern of everyone conversations.
Yeah.
So the conversation is really, really very, very central in this policy.
Actually, my office, we have the website. So later on, in 1 hour, maybe our event now is on our website. You can see my our picture there. Yeah.
Okay.
Photo pass.
But do you have a Facebook page?
Or I have it. Fan page.
Or blog.
Yeah. Right. I also have my own what do you call it, in academia.edu.
Yeah.
My follower around 17,000. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh. Oh yeah. They are all bad guy.
Okay, any next questions? Yes, please.
Do you hear me? Yes. Hi, hello. My name is Alice Tullier. I'm working for International Finance Corporation, so IFC. I know we're trying to help you in the local team in Jakarta. So my question to you is, you mentioned several times the private sector. So how do you see, and where do you see the private sector helping you? I know about water and waste, but any other sector? And what are the challenges that you face on your day-to-day to be able to attract them into the grand design and into the urban design of Jakarta?
Here, when we're talking about green design of green building, it's easy to involve the private sector. But when we're talking about urban farming, it is difficult. When you're talking about disaster reduction, it's difficult. So not all of the green design is easy to involve the private sector. But when talking about green building, they are really get involved in our process. Even now, we, according to our green design, we would like to revise our governor law, and now we are finalizing the revised version of the governor law, and then the private sector involved in the process. They give us many suggestions, because to make sure that we all can. What do you call it, can implement the governor law. Not like before, too difficult, and then we get the resistance from the private sector. But now it seems like it is much easier now. But when we're talking about child-friendly city, green design, it is difficult to get support from private sector. When talking about urban farming, talking about water, not too easy. But sometimes in Jakarta, we get incentive to the private sector to get involved in our program. Like when they need to build what do you call it? KLB apa? What do you call it in English? Yeah, more floor, and then they contribute to our program. Like the apartment that we built now in our green zone, that our private project, it is the funding coming from the private sector because they got incentive, because we give them more floor to their building. So that's the way we try to involve the private sector, but not always success in a way.
How about the role of CSR?
CSR, yes, but we are talking about grand design.
Yeah.
But in a normal program, yeah, the CSR they develop RTH, apa RTH? Huh? The park. You know, in Jakarta we call it Air Petra. It is a park for the children. Many of the maybe 60% of the park is coming from the private sector. Not only CSR, but including the contribution, because we provide them with the more floor, so they contribute to our program. But when we're talking about the green design, because since this is like idea, a commitment, and consensus, we still having problem to involve them.
Yeah, something like in Singapore, we have this so-called the privately owned public space.
Yeah.
For example, like they're opening the private land, like Orchard Road, for example, like the big pedestrian actually is a private land, or some area like Tanjung Pagar Center, and all these things. And as I heard, there is some effort also in Jakarta, right, to do something like Kuningan, like
yeah.
But it's work in progress. Maybe I just received a warning like 5 minutes, so maybe it's the last questions, final questions. That okay.
Thank you. Very interesting lectures. I have two questions. One is aging population. Does Jakarta face aging population? What are your population 60 and above? Second question, I've been approached by a few developers. I myself is a developer also, because of your traffic congestion. So they say, you know, traveling time to work and all this is a challenge. And is there an opportunity? They seek my, you know, advice or help to secure some land nearer to the city so the office workers can travel shorter distance to work. Thank you.
So the question is regarding the aging population, right? I think tomorrow we are going to learn from Singapore, right? One of our big issues now in Jakarta is, when we're talking about apartment, how we can provide our senior citizen with the apartment. How different the apartment for the senior citizen with the millennial, people. So we are really interested. Would like to learn from Singapore. I think tomorrow, we have discussion regarding aging population housing in Singapore, or Friday, in Singapore, because we don't know yet how to deal with this problem. But regarding the traffic congestion now, we starting to develop TOD in 18 locations in Jakarta, surrounding a rail station, and then to make sure that we can reduce the trip generation all over Jakarta. We believe if we can have built this 18 TOD location in the next 5 to 10 years, we can survive. We can solve the traffic jam problem. So our solution for this question is TOD. This also we are going to talk about this regarding TOD. So there are many solutions that we believe Singapore is really a good example that we can learn. We are not going to be like Singapore. It's difficult, but we try to learn the experience of the Singapore, and then we try to implement in the context of Jakarta.
All right. So I think with that note, comparing Jakarta and Singapore is not comparable, right? It's not apple to apple. Jakarta is a city. Singapore is a country. It's not just a kid. And then, of course, population-wise, we have 5 million, you have 10 million. So Jakarta is almost double. You're talking about density, Jakarta is 14,000 per square kilometer. We only have 730 per square kilometers. A huge difference. But size-wise, it's almost the same. If we only talk about Jakarta city, it's not Jabodetabek, right? 660, and Singapore slightly bigger, 720. But of course, there's a lot of points that we can learn from each other. And from your talk and this discussion just now, I make several notes here that probably can be something that we can learn from Jakarta. So it's not just Jakarta learning from Singapore, but how we Singaporean also can learn from Jakarta. First is the importance of consensus and harmony, which is important to be achieved through talking, dialogue, with patience. So it's not top down, it's not by forcing very hard kind of policies, but to achieve consensus is one thing that is very important. And then second, that is very interesting, is don't touch approach. If we don't know that the problem is big or is it small, we don't know yet, then just wait and see. So patience is important. And then if we do touching something, want to do something on the policy level, just do the Tai Chi thing. Let's manage the fluid and consider everything as flows, as not as, as solid or a wall. So we don't build boxes, but actually we manage the frame. It's just like planting the rice, you know. It's sometimes you cannot avoid that you have some wild plants coming out on the rice field. But at the end of the day, we are planting rice. And the most important is how to manage the grid, how to manage the fluid that it may happen. And then another point that you raise is quite interesting is the importance of middle platform through social media, through this engagement. Keep talking. You know, discussing to make this idea, common idea, always floating. So I guess the final one that is quite important that you mentioned first time when we asked you the question is what is the key of success of this grand design to float regardless the difficulties with the fragmented governments, with the elections that is coming every 5 years, dealing with the mayors, with three governors, with a very you know, general kind of policies, not very technical. I think the things that we mentioned just in the beginning is that probably there is a common dreams, something that is unconsciously was always in the heart of every people in Jakarta. That in one word is called love, right? So because everybody loves Jakarta. So regardless the governor, regardless the situation, the flood, the riots, whatever, but everybody still loves Jakarta, regardless the political party who will control the city, regardless the, you know, but because of this love, then this will hold everyone together. I don't know whether it's correct or not, because I'm just trying to think about my own, you know, thinking, but maybe before we end this session, maybe you can have a last word and to address this before we can close this.
Yeah. From my experience, when we're talking about grand design, when talking about develop the resilient city strategy, we learned that the government cannot do it alone. We need help. This from my experience. So. Collaborative approach is a must, and then try to be more open to the people is, I think it is important to be more patient. Sometimes I think like I'm going to be like, what do you call it, people without any emotional thing, it's really, really patient. So. The bottom line is the government need to be working with any stakeholders.
So it's openness and humility.
Yeah.
So that's probably the key to success. And I wish you all the best for the next steps in Jakarta progress. And maybe we can just put our hands together for a very inspiring talk this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Oswar and Dr. Widodo, for the lively discussion, which I believe has helped us gain a better understanding of Jakarta and what grand design is all about. We'd now like to invite Mr. Khoo Teng Chai, Executive Director of CLC, on stage to present a token of appreciation to all the speakers, please. This is a copy of CLC's latest publication, Reflections, which captures the highlights and key discussions from the World City Summit 2018. Thank you for being a part of today's event. We hope you have enjoyed today's lecture. Do join us for our next lecture on 4th of April, The Healthy Streets Approach. For the latest updates on our CLC lecture series and publications, do visit www.clc.gov.sg or follow us on Facebook at CLCSG. Thank you.